Andre the Giant has been the subject of everything from street art to t-shirts and documentaries. His impressive mass and abilities inspired fear, awe, and curiosity everywhere he went, along with mythical stories that defy belief. From the moment of birth, Andre René Roussimoff was notable for his size. When he was born on May 19, 1946, he weighed over 13 pounds, or the average weight of a four-month-old baby. Despite his large size, Andre was a normal kid who spent his childhood helping his parents manage their farm in their pastoral home of Moulin, France. The Roussimoff family's humble farming life left little room for luxury or extravagance. The children got oranges instead of toys for Christmas and walked the mile and a half to and from school unless someone in the village was around to drive them. One of those people was the famous Irish novelist, playwright, and Nobel Prize laureate Samuel Beckett, who moved to France in 1937. Andre was loved and happy at home, but he wanted something more than a farmer's life. Genetics and fate would grant him his wish.
I use what does God give me. I'm not supernatural, I just myself.
The human body has numerous checks and balances to maintain stasis, but they don't always function properly. When a person's pituitary gland produces too much growth hormone, it results in a condition known as acromegaly. It's an incredibly rare condition, the most obvious symptom of which is gigantism, which results in excess height and girth, especially in the hands and feet, as well as enlarged facial features. Some less obvious symptoms include sleep apnea, cardiovascular disease, hypertension, diabetes, arthritis, heart enlargement, spinal cord compression, and an increased risk of colon cancer, among other ailments. It sounds like a constant, painful, never-ending fight with gravity, especially for a physical performer. Precisely when Andre became aware of his condition remains unknown. It's possible he learned about his condition as early as 1970, while wrestling in Japan with a fellow wrestler who also had the disorder. But the official diagnosis may have come as late as 1981, when Andre's body was starting to succumb to later stages of the illness. Regardless, Andre chose to leave his condition untreated, fearing any treatment would compromise his career and lifestyle. This decision sealed his fate. Acromegaly has more than a 50% success rate via surgery, but when left untreated, it can result in premature death, often before the age of 45. At age 14, Andre took one step closer to destiny when he stopped attending school to start working full-time. Rumor has led many to believe he dropped out due to his large size, but nothing could be further from the truth. He was never the bookish type, and left because French children weren't required to attend school past that age. He spent the next few years lugging 250-pound sacks of grain around the family farm and working odd jobs at factories and delivering goods in neighboring villages. It was during this time Andre had a chance encounter with the man who would launch his wrestling career, the coach and promoter Robert Lejat. When Lejat encountered Andre while working in the small village of La Ferté-sous-Jouarre, Andre was only 18 years old. Yet already over 6.5 feet tall and weighing more than 250 pounds. Lejat saw a future wrestling star in the young man and offered to train him at his school in Paris.
One day when wrestler was hurt and they don't know who to take his place, then they call me. I said, I can do that, I've never been in the ring in my life.
The year was 1965, and it would be a challenging one for the Giant. He didn't earn any money training, and sometimes resorted to sleeping in the Paris metro stations. As a way to make ends meet, Andre took on more jobs that complemented his size, including offering protection to prostitutes in the area's red light district. After a year of hard work, Andre had his first official wrestling match on January 25, 1966. He proved to be a natural talent. Successful wrestlers aren't just skilled athletes, they're superb actors, and Andre was excellent at appearing menacing and even larger than he already was. People believed he was capable of mass destruction, partly because he wrestled under the name Jean Ferry, which was an homage to a mythical Greek lumberjack known as Le Grand Ferry, who killed 85 adversaries using only his axe. Just 2 weeks after the launch of his wrestling career, Andre had his first televised match. He struck a lean figure and wrestled in a very technical style, full of hip tosses and head scissors that would be almost unrecognizable to fans later in North America. Andre's popularity followed him around France, then on to other parts of Europe. In 1969, he made his debut in the UK, followed shortly thereafter by Africa, Japan, and the Middle East, then moving on to Montreal to expand his career into the Americas. At the time, he had reached a reported height of 7'4" and was also said to weigh 390 pounds. As with a lot of wrestlers, those numbers might be exaggerated. Wrestling Observer Newsletter editor Dave Meltzer told the LA Times in 1993 that Andre was 6'11" at his tallest. However, there's no actual height documentation on record. Regardless, what is known is his career blew up even further when he relocated to Canada in 1971. That same year, his rapidly expanding fame brought him to even more countries for the first time, including New Zealand and the United States. Despite his massive size, Andre always did his best to avoid confrontation. This was evident from the beginning of his career, when, according to the Andre biography, The Eighth Wonder of the World, he made a respectful request to a veteran opponent, saying, "If I'm clumsy, forgive me, and please don't hurt me." As his reputation grew, he found himself in a position of leadership in the locker room. Wrestling was a very gruff, rough-and-tumble sort of industry in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, full of cutthroat individuals looking to encroach on each other's territories and promotions. Andre enjoyed the camaraderie that came with pro wrestling, however, and is remembered for being friendly, caring, and generous. Those close to him also came to know Andre as a sensitive fellow who tired of the constant, inescapable stares and harassment from strangers. Unlike other superstars, Andre couldn't hide under a coat and hat. He was instantly recognizable and stood out easily everywhere he went, leaving him with few places he could seek privacy and solitude. Andre was pivoted even further into the limelight when he transcended wrestling and launched his movie career. His fairy tale size made him idyllic for fantastical roles when special effects technology was more limited. One memorable example was when he was cast as a howling Sasquatch in The $6 Million Man. Andre became known for his role as the gentle and friendly Fezzik the Giant in The Princess Bride in 1987, a role that gave his amiable personality an opportunity to shine alongside his physical prowess. His sweet smile and silly comebacks are a huge reason for the film's status as a perennial favorite among generations of viewers.
It's not my fault being the biggest and the strongest. I don't even exercise.
While Andre's career blossomed, so too did the many legends that would follow him the rest of his short life. Although he started his career as a light drinker, by the time he reached his peak, his drinking capacity was particularly noteworthy. On ESPN's Dan Le Batard show, Ric Flair recounted a 14-hour flight from Chicago to Tokyo when Andre drank their commercial flight dry of vodka. He reportedly racked up a $40,000 bar tab while working on set of The Princess Bride. Hulk Hogan has claimed he saw Andre consume a case of wine in 3 hours. Sadly, as the years wore on, Andre's extreme drinking habits were driven more by his deteriorating condition rather than his desire to party. At his heaviest, Andre was billed at a whopping 550 pounds, a far cry from the slim, technical-style wrestler who preferred dairy to alcohol. As his pain grew more unbearable, Andre sought ways to escape it. However, after seeing other wrestlers succumb to addiction, he avoided using prescription painkillers and compensated with what he felt was the lesser of evils, pushing onward through a haze of agony and booze. Andre's unusual size also severely limited his mobility in ways few ever have to consider. Unless it was custom-made to his dimensions, nothing ever fit. Everyday items like chairs, beds, toilets, airplane seats, shoes, cars. Imagine the discomfort Andre experienced throughout his life, everywhere he went. On top of the inconveniences he experienced due to acromegaly, the condition also caused Andre continuous and ever-worsening pain, especially in his knees, back, and neck. His joints just couldn't handle the weight of all that mass. And his fatigue and other symptoms got worse along with the pain. Things were so bad, he required the assistance of cables to catch Robin Wright during a pivotal scene in The Princess Bride.
He wasn't that well during course of the movie.
Yeah, and I always thought that the hard part would be his performance, but the wrestling was the hardest thing for him.
In 1981, he broke his ankle and saw the writing on the wall. His wrestling days were numbered, and he knew it. He didn't even know how long he had to live. He shared the information with Vince McMahon Jr., with whom he'd developed a relationship over the years. Taking his confidence sincerely, McMahon offered Andre an opportunity for the perfect culmination to his legendary career. While Andre was busy developing his wrestling career, the industry was also evolving significantly. This was thanks in large part to Vince McMahon Jr., a legend in his own right, not just in pro wrestling, but cable television and business in general. He was the first wrestling owner to see beyond local territories and envision a world united under one brand. After an aggressive and controversial takeover of surrounding territories, McMahon succeeded in launching the World Wrestling Federation. Not only was he the first to unite American territories, he also revolutionized the concept of pay-per-view television through featured buy-ins like WrestleMania. At just a few years of operation, McMahon was determined to solidify the WWF's staying power. He conceived of a main event for the upcoming WrestleMania III that would do that very thing, Hulk Hogan versus Andre the Giant. Prior to that point, Andre had always played a good guy, or babyface in wrestling vernacular, and was longtime friends with Hogan. It would be the first time in Andre's WWF career that he was scripted to lose a match, as well as play a bad guy, otherwise known as a heel.
Andre lost to Hogan, with the Hulkster famously scooping up Andre and body slamming him, and Hogan became an even bigger international star. Of course, without Andre's willingness to cooperate with this grand plan, Hogan would never be able to lift the Giant. Andre played his part to help all of wrestling, as he always did.
Throughout the course of his career, Andre's public image was protected, and he rarely discussed his health candidly, so his visible deterioration was shocking. Hulk Hogan even choreographed every move of their history-making match to complement Andre's remaining strength and limit the stress on his back and joints. Post-WrestleMania, Andre's condition continued to worsen rapidly. After attempting to continue his wrestling career as a guest commentator, Andre officially retired in 1992. He returned to his roots, living a quiet life on a ranch in a village in Richmond County, North Carolina, until he passed away on January 27, 1993. In a sad twist of fate, he was visiting Paris to attend his father's funeral when he passed. Later that year, Andre became the first inductee into the WWE Hall of Fame, where his legacy will continue to inspire fans for generations to come. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more Looper videos about your favorite wrestlers are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.